basically, I'm a disaster chaplain in New York. And basically, us disaster chaplains are from all different religions, basically. And we could be deployed out to a disaster. It could be like, you know, like I was deployed to a fire, to a crane collapse, or many, many different kinds of things. And basically, I'm going to read an account from my journal of something that I did last month that I was deployed on. This took place in February 2009. I was wearing my bright green vest that identified me as a disaster chaplain in the city of New York. I walked down past City Hall. The cops by City Hall told me I was needed and pointed to the direction I should go in. The directions were not very clear to me. It took me a lot of walking and looking and long turns to locate the area where I was to be deployed. I was finding my way through a maze that is Chinatown, New York City. I paused and reflected. Dear God, help me not to be so nervous. A young, smiling Chinese woman with a child in her arms caught my eye and she kindly motioned to me. I followed her for about 3 blocks, around corners, up crowded streets filled with these beautiful Chinese stores with all kinds of colored things in them. She pointed across the street and I thanked her. I checked the address on my paper. I was in the right place. I looked around. There were many, many people in uniform. Some were from the Red Cross, police, fire department, and other city agencies. I walked inside the building and I located my contact, Julia, who's the head of the New York City Chaplaincy Services. We walked around and she said, "Well, Barbara, you're on your own. Most people here don't speak any English. Do what you can." I was introduced to my Red Cross counterparts and the person from the Department of Mental Health. I walked into this large room, like a football field, with a high, high ceiling, the way they used to build them about 20 years ago. Around the periphery of the room, I saw bright blue khaki cops. You know, the kind that get taken out at nap time for preschoolers. Only now, grown-ups were lying on them all around the room. White blankets with a Red Cross symbol were draped around the shoulders of most of the older Chinese people. Some were kind of sitting hunched over, drinking from paper cups. Some wore Red Cross socks and had their cozy beds and leave their home because of a fire. Most of the older Chinese people didn't speak any English, and I imagined how isolated they must feel not being able to communicate. The children, however, did speak English, and I observed them going over to check on the older folk. I sat down with a father who was holding a light-haired baby boy. He told me that the baby was 11 months old and his 12-year-old daughter sat next to him. She was handing him a bottle with some milk in it and then a tissue. She spoke English very well, while Dad kind of stumbled over the words. It was evident that she felt responsible for both Dad and baby. She went to a public school in the area and she told me she loved art. The baby reached out for me and I held him. Her daughter told me that her mom was out working and would come by much later. A couple of the children began to walk past me, looking at me curiously. I smiled at them. I remembered how children have a built-in radar. They gravitate to places where it's good for them. they brought a ball over and I rolled it along the floor for them. And when I looked around, it seemed that more children had appeared to investigate this minister wearing a collar who was playing ball. I acknowledged my Red Cross team members who told me they had already given out cookies and hot drinks and they were in the process of bringing in hot Chinese food.